What a celebration Easter is for us. Easter is a special holiday. It's a special holiday because we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. We celebrate all that he has accomplished for us. We spent Friday, Good Friday, in grief and gratitude for all that the death of Jesus Christ provided for us. And then on Saturday, we spent time in reflection just thinking about the time between Good Friday, where he died for our sins, and then Sunday, where he woke up from the dead and was risen from the grave. That day on Saturday where we were reminded of the potential confusion, I'm sure the confusion and the doubt that must have overwhelmed those disciples. So we've been there on Good Friday, we've been there Saturday, and now we're here today on Sunday remembering the good news of his resurrection. Now we're here where the stone that once covered the grave of our Messiah, Jesus, was rolled away, where that tomb was found empty, and where our Savior, Jesus, is now risen. Today, as we look at the story of the resurrection, we're going to track just a few of those stories in the book of Luke. And as we look at this story, what I want us to see is that there are rumors of the resurrected Jesus. In fact, the disciples of Jesus are actually having encounters with angels and with Jesus Christ himself. So I want to dig into this story, but before we begin, there's four progressions in each of these stories that I just want to draw your attention to, and then I want you to see them as we work our way through the stories. The first is that every time the disciples come to the empty tomb, or every time we encounter the disciples after the death of Jesus Christ, they are confused. Now, no doubt, they're confused because their Messiah has died, but they're also confused because they didn't understand or realize at the time that their Messiah, although laid in the grave and would be there for 3 days, would wake up and be victorious over death. What they didn't realize caused a lot of confusion. We're going to see that. And secondly, there's a ton of appearances, like sudden appearances in the Easter story. I don't know why it happens that way. I'm going to kind of make light of that in just a little bit. But for whatever reason, there's confusion, and then there are sudden appearances. And then that's always followed by a reminder of what God has said in the Scriptures. The prophecy concerning Jesus, in terms of his death and his burial and his resurrection, there are prophecies concerning the Easter story that date back hundreds of years, even thousands of years before Jesus Christ was even born. So they're being reminded then of all that God has said, being reminded of all that Jesus has said and done. And then lastly, there's always a realization or a reminder that leads them to life change. There's a changed perspective. There's a changed life for these disciples. And so as we read this story, that's what I want you to see. I want you to see all of this progression. So let's dig in. We're going to be in Luke chapter 24. Now, there are four biographies of Jesus in the Bible. Now, they're more than biographies. These are God's word to us, written to us, though, inspired by the Spirit through four men, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The books are named after them. We're going to be in Luke, one of those accounts of the life and ministry of Jesus. And we're going to be at the back of Luke in chapter 24 toward the end. So I want you to get over there. If you've got a phone or an app or you've got a Bible, I welcome you to join with me. If you don't, the words should be up on the screen for you. So we're going to read along, and I'm going to provide a running commentary as we read. So nothing crazy, but just hang in there with me as I read. Luke chapter 24, and we'll begin in verses 1 through 4. But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them in dazzling robes. I want you to stop there. First, dazzling robes. All right, so Luke clearly must have gotten this account from those ladies, or this is some word-of-mouth account from Luke. First of all, he's a dude. Dudes, you know, I didn't see anyone here, any dude here saying, that is a dazzling sports coat. Clearly, he got this account from those ladies. So these ladies show up, they're freaked out, they're puzzled, and what they remember is that there are some dudes that show up with some dazzling robes. Hilarious to me. Guys, God has a sense of humor. And what I love about the Easter story is that God shares with us some of those humorous moments in the resurrection account. And part of me wonders, I just want to ask Jesus when I see him, hey, did you just keep randomly showing up in the middle of rooms after your resurrection to just kind of have a good time with these guys, to really just wake them up? And I wonder if he might laugh at that. There's good news here. We've grieved over the loss of our Messiah Friday, but today is Sunday, and we rejoice with glad hearts in all that Jesus has accomplished for us. And so here what happens is there are two men who suddenly appear, and then what happens, of course, is that the women are terrified. Look at verses 5 to 7. These next few verses for me are some of the most poetic words in the whole account of the resurrection. I love them. It's the angels speaking in verses 5 to 7, and they say, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? Why are you here in the cemetery? Why are you here at the grave looking for someone who is alive?" They go on to say, "He's not dead. He isn't here. He has risen from the grave. Remember what he told you?" And here again, we see that they're being reminded of what God said. "Remember what he told you, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day?" You see, there was confusion, a sudden appearance, a reminder of who Jesus was, what he said, what he did, and it's almost like they should have known. It's almost like they should have expected it. They didn't really need visions or miracles or some surprise element for them to actually just realize that what was happening in this death and resurrection story is exactly what Jesus said would happen. It's not that Jesus isn't into visions or miracles. It's not that God isn't into those things. It's just that he's more interested in our faith. He's more interested in strengthening our faith. One of the things that I've been thinking about a lot the last few weeks is that faith is the ability to see what you can't see because God said it's true. You know, I think for a lot of times if we think about the opposite of living by faith, we might actually think that that is doubt. But as we've been looking at this passage and as I've been thinking about it, I wouldn't say that doubt necessarily is the opposite of living by faith. I think living by sight might be the opposite of living by faith. These disciples find themselves at a place where they're having a hard time living by faith, and it's because they're living by only what they can see with their physical eyes. At this point, Messiah has died. The one they had hoped would be the Savior is now in the grave, and that's all they can see. And what God wants to do is strengthen their faith to see, when they can't see it with their eyes, what God has promised would happen. God does this to strengthen our faith. If God says he loves you, living by faith, or I should say living by sight, actually, it means that when things are good, you feel like God loves you. And when things are bad, you feel like God doesn't love you. Have you ever ridden that roller coaster of emotion or that roller coaster of wonderment? Does God love me? Does he not? Why is he allowing this to happen to me? I don't feel loved. What's happening in that moment is we're living by sight. Just by what we can see. Our circumstances, our surrounding is informing us in terms of what is reality. And what the resurrection story teaches us is that actually reality is informed by what God says is true, even if we can't see it with our physical eyes. That's what's happening here in this story. Living by faith, then, would be the opposite of living by sight. It would be that we actually, when God says he loves you, we believe it, even if it doesn't feel that way, even if our circumstances don't lead us to think that that's true. This is living by faith. And we have a hard time with that, don't we? We're not the only ones, though. As we read this story, I want to continue reading. We're not the only ones who have a hard time trusting or believing in God. Look at verses 8 through 11. I want you to read it with me. We're in verses 8 through 11 of Luke chapter 24. It says, "Then the woman remembered that he had said this." So they do remember. They have a realization moment. They have a moment where they are reminded of this. In verse 9, they rushed back to the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. But the story sounded like nonsense to the men, so they didn't believe it. Do you guys catch that? These women are so overwhelmed at the good news of the resurrection of Jesus that they run back to go tell the disciples. These are the 12 disciples minus one because Judas is now no longer with them. But these are the 12 disciples. These are the apostles of Jesus. They will go on to turn the world upside down along with the rest of all of Christ's followers. And when these women come back from the grave saying, "It's empty, he's not there. We saw two men in dazzling robes, you'll never believe it. And Jesus is gone, he's not here. The men said that he woke up from the dead." And these guys, as they're sitting there, the closest friends and followers of Jesus, I would imagine, are actually sitting in doubt and disbelief. It sounds like a fairy tale to them. Some of you might actually be thinking the same thing. I love Easter. It's a wonderful thing, but it's all just like fairy tales. It's not true, is it? You know what? I don't blame you. I don't think any of us would look down our noses at anyone else who might actually be thinking that. I mean, we have to relate to that. After all, it's the closest of his friends and followers who actually, to them, it sounds like nonsense, and they don't believe it. And I think for us, what it does for us is it puts us all on level playing field, because at the core, we all struggle or suffer with what's called unbelief. And that's what's happening to these disciples. The women realize something that changes their perspective. In reality, it changes their lives, and they run to tell the others. I don't really have a more significant point than this, other than if you've felt doubt or despair or discouragement, you're in good company. These followers of Jesus were experiencing much the same thing. They saw with Jesus for over 3 years the things he did, the things he said, and they still had a hard time living by faith instead of living by sight. And so I think what we need is what they needed, and I think eventually received, which was affirmation, a reminder, a realization of the good news about what Jesus had done. There's another story that begins in verse 13, and I want to read this story with you. So if you're in the Bible, let's look at this next story. The pattern is the same in this story. It's another account of his followers who didn't yet understand. Another sudden appearance, but this time it's Jesus. Read verses 13 to 27 with me. It says, that same day of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened here the last few days. And look at what Jesus says in verse 19. What things? I just love it. It's funny to me. Jesus is drawing a conversation out of these guys. And what I think that tells me is that although God's great and glorious, and I think he's transcendent, far above anything we know or imagine or could ever relate to, and yet he's imminent, he's close by, he's walking with us, and he's drawing these men out. He's covered their eyes, they can't see, and he says, so what things? Let's talk for a minute. What I love is that Jesus is conversant. He's talking with us, wants to get to know us. He's entering into a relationship with these two guys, and they're experiencing that. So he says, what things? And they say, the things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth. Look at how they describe him. Look at how they've forgotten who he really was. They think he's just a man. They say, look, he was just a man, the man from Nazareth. He was a prophet, so there's a prophet. He was a powerful miracle worker, and he's a mighty teacher in all the eyes of God and people, but our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel, and all this happened 3 days ago. Then some women from our group of followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said that his body was missing and that he had seen angels who told them that Jesus is alive. And some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. And they're sad about that. It doesn't make any sense. And Jesus says to them in verse 25, you foolish people, you find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that Messiah would have to suffer these things before entering into his glory? What's he doing? The same pattern we discussed. Confusion followed by sudden appearance, followed by a reminder of all that God's word has said, all that Jesus has said would happen. So as Jesus begins to remind them, he's walking them through the scriptures. It says in verse 27, then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets and explaining from the scriptures all the things concerning himself. Why do you think that God kept them from recognizing who Jesus was? I have just two, and maybe you can come up with some more, and I'd love to chat with you after. But the two ones that come to mind for me are, number one, I think he keeps them, those two men, from knowing who Jesus is, first of all, so that he can draw out their unbelief and expose that these men really are walking in unbelief. They're walking in sight, not by faith. And isn't that so true of so many of us, so many of our experiences? But I think there's a second reason that God might actually prevent them from seeing who Jesus was. And that was so that he could actually use the scriptures to convince them of who Jesus was and what Jesus had accomplished. In other words, what I'm saying is that God can use miracles, and he often does. And God can use special circumstances, and he often does. But here after the resurrection story, what Jesus does for us is he demonstrates that at its core and at its foundation, all we really need to know who Jesus is and to know what he has accomplished for us can be found right here in God's word. That's all we need. I feel like the rest is just whatever God uses to wake us up, whatever he uses to energize us with good news, and whatever else he uses to confirm the message that we find in Scripture. But what I love about this resurrection account here is that they're always just saying, hey guys, listen, it was talked about, it was prophesied. We should know these things because God's word says them. And for me, that's just added confirmation that anything we need to know can be found in God's word. You might be looking for some miracle, or you might be looking for some special thing to happen to you, or some prayer to be answered before you're willing to follow Jesus. And you know, it doesn't always take a miracle to receive one. What I think can happen is that we can just be talking about God's word, explaining the good news about what Jesus has done, and our eyes can be opened to realize the truth. That's the power of God's word. God's spirit working through God's word. So that's what I think is happening here, and that's why I think God allows them to be sort of blinded to who Jesus is. So as we progress in the story, what we find is that these men actually, as they come to realize who Jesus is, I want you to see this story. What we realize here for them is that all we really need as it pertains to understanding who Jesus is that God would open our eyes like he does for these men. Have you ever asked Jesus to open your eyes? Have you ever said, Lord, help me understand who you are? Help me understand more about what you've done. Help me understand the significance of this Easter story. Have you ever asked God that? That's what I think needs to happen for so many of us. Whether you've been a Christian for 30 or 50 years, or maybe you're not yet a believer, you're not yet a Christian, and you're asking God some of these questions, what I want to share with you is good news. He welcomes and invites you to ask him. And he's willing to show. What if today you could recognize that he's been working in your life to bring you to this point, to bring you to this Easter service, to bring you to hear this message perhaps? What if you could see that he was showing you and wanting to show you the great love he has and the great length to which he has gone in saving us and rescuing us from sin, from death, and from the enemy himself? What if today God's drawing on you into a relationship with him? It's more than possible. I believe that for many of us, that's what's happening. And here, I want you to see it's happening in this story too. So I'm not just making this up. Here in verse 28 through 29, I want you to see that Jesus acts as if he were going on. And I want you to see that as we look at this, what happens is that Jesus continues walking. There's two men. There's Jesus. He showed up randomly. He's talking with them. He draws them into conversation. And they get to where they're going. And Jesus says, well, it was really nice talking to you guys. And he makes as if he's going to keep going. And the guys say, wait, where are you going? Why don't you come and spend a little bit more time with us? What I love about Jesus is what we see here in his humility, his approachability. I love that Jesus is humble and he makes as though he's just going to keep going. He's unassuming. And he's not pushing himself on them. And I think it's the same for many of you. You may have wrestled with doubt or discouragement. The Spirit of God himself is not pushing himself on you. I think he is interested in a faith-based relationship with you where you grow in learning to trust him. Now, he'll open your eyes, as we'll see in the story in just a minute, but there's no coercion in this story. They begged him, he stayed. He wanted to stay, he wanted to see if they wanted him to stay. Isn't that amazing? I think sometimes we think God's going to do whatever God's going to do, and while that's true, we might take too much from him if we don't acknowledge that he desires friendship. That Jesus desires friendship with us, that he desires genuine relationship with us. So look at what happens here in this story. I think there's something endearing in the humility that Christ shows. It's unassuming. It's him leading us to ask. It's him showing us he's willing, and I can't get over it. It endears our hearts to him even more. And just a minute ago, I asked, have you ever asked God to open your eyes to understand who Jesus is? Well, if you could see that he was willing to talk to you, if you could see that he was humble, that he was approachable, wouldn't that help? There's no one, as you read the story of who Jesus is, there's no one that Jesus wouldn't spend time with. There was no one who was too far gone, or there was no one that had pushed him away for way too long, and that he wouldn't forgive them when they turned to him. When they turned and embraced him as the life-giving Savior that he was, he always received them openly, and he would do the same for you and I. Look at what happens when they realize who they've been talking with. Here in verse 30 to 35, it says, as they sat down to eat, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them. And suddenly their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. This is fantastic. Then they said to each other, didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scriptures to us? Guys, you know what that feels like? That feels like being here gathered together with so many of us from Redemption or Anchor or just from Hampton Roads, and we're gathered to worship and we're singing songs of praise to Jesus, and we're hearing that he woke up from the dead, and we're hearing that he has the power to save, and there's something in many of us where our hearts begin to burn. We begin to rejoice in this good news. We begin to feel an embrace of this good news of Jesus. That's what was happening to these men. Their hearts begin to burn within them, and they acknowledge that. They say, didn't our hearts begin to burn as he explained the scriptures to us? What Jesus does is so beautiful. He doesn't show up with flashing lights. It's not quite like the Christmas story with all the angels and everything. He just shows up. He keeps them from seeing who he really is, and all he does is explain the scriptures, and the scriptures are good enough for the Spirit to use in waking us up. Our hearts begin to burn when God uses his scripture. So within the hour, I love this, verse 33, remember it was 7 miles. They'd gotten there, it's nighttime, and within the hour, verse 33, they were back on their way to Jerusalem. They found the 11 disciples and the others who had gathered with them. So they wake everybody up, I'm sure, and they say, hey, the Lord really has risen. He appeared to Peter. And then they were all sharing these stories. And the two from Emmaus shared their story of how Jesus had appeared to them, and they were walking along the road and how they recognized who it was as he was breaking bread, and on and on and on. Then in verse 36 to 40, with another element of surprise in the resurrection story, Jesus appears out of nowhere, of course. Jesus appears and he says, peace be with you. It's like he knew they'd be freaked out. He shows up and he says, hey, peace, guys. Ugh! They're freaked out, and I'm sure they are, and they were. We see that. But what I don't understand is, why does he just show up in the middle of the room? So here they are sharing stories of resurrection. We've seen Jesus. We've seen him. We talked with him. It was him. We really know it's true. And then Jesus just shows up right in the middle of the room. I don't even know how that happens. But why doesn't he just knock? Why doesn't he just like sort of let them in easy on this thing? Why doesn't he just knock on the door? They open up the door, and they go, whoa, 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 it's Jesus. And then they go, guys, come over here and look. And there's like this build-up to like Jesus is in the room. He doesn't do that. For whatever reason, and I love it, he just shows up right in the middle of them. And there's Jesus appearing out of nowhere and right in the middle of the room, and he offers a customary greeting, which makes this even better. So he shows up in the room out of nowhere. It freaks them out, and then he uses a customary greeting, peace be with you. It's what you would have said if you encountered someone. So he shows up, and he basically says the equivalent of, how's it going, guys? Just fantastic. Again, just unbelievable. So it makes it even better. And after all that they had seen, it baffles me, even still with the verses up on the screen here, it baffles me even still that they thought it was a ghost. Verses 36 through 40 say, and just as they were talking about it, Jesus himself was suddenly standing there with them. Peace be with you, he said. But the whole group was startled and frightened, thinking they were seeing a ghost. Unbelievable, guys. And then Jesus says, what are you so scared of? I don't get it. What's going on, guys? Why are you frightened? He asked. Why are your hearts filled with so much doubt? Why are you living by sight? Why are you judging everything that happens to you according to what you can see right in front of you? Why don't you believe what I've been telling you? Why won't you take a step of faith? Why won't you live by faith? That's what he's encouraging them to see. He says, look at my hands, look at my feet. You can see that it's really me. Touch me. Make sure that I'm not a ghost. Ghosts don't have bodies like I do. Verse 40, he spoke and he showed them his hands and feet. And so naturally Jesus says, what's wrong? Why are you frightened? Why are you filled with doubt? And then he shows them his scars on his hands and feet. Did you ever notice in the resurrection story that all of his scars are gone? I mean, when we look at prophecy in the Bible, the Old Testament, and prophecy about the coming and death of Jesus, and then we look at the account of the crucifixion of Jesus, what we learn is that he was beaten so badly, he was beyond recognition. So when he wakes up from the dead, where are all those scars at? I'm choosing to believe, actually, that he kept the ones that he has on purpose. I believe he woke up with a new body, and he kept the ones in his hands and in his feet on purpose. One, so we would forever glorify the one who was slain for us. But two, to strengthen our faith, to cause us to have eternal joy and wonder at all that he has accomplished for us. And that's exactly what happens here in verse 41. All those scars are gone, but he keeps these for us. And look at verses 41 to 42. They were filled with joy and wonder. And then Jesus says something that everyone is expecting him to say at this moment. It's a mic drop moment. Got anything good to eat, guys? I mean, this is unbelievable to me. Jesus walks in. I mean, he doesn't even walk in. Sorry. I mean, I'm getting the story. He shows up in the middle of the room, freaks everybody out. And then he goes over to the fridge and he opens it and he's like, hey, what you guys got good? It's just unbelievable, this story of resurrection. It's so good. It's so wonderful. You can never get enough out of this story. So Jesus says, what you guys got to eat around here? And it's so funny. These next two verses are probably the funniest in the whole thing. You guys got to see it. They slide a piece of fish across the table. Look at it. They grab a piece of broiled fish. I can't even get over it. I got to read it for you. It says, they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And then it says, they watched him eat it. So here's Jesus. He shows up, freaks everybody out, and then he goes, what you guys got good to eat? And they're thinking, that's not what we expected. And so they kind of look at it. I don't think they ever took their eyes off of Jesus. They grab a piece of fish, like it's over here somewhere. They grab something, put it on a plate, slide it across the table, and then they back up ever so slightly. And they're still just looking at him. And I don't care what any church historian says or any commentary says. You never convinced me that it was culturally appropriate back then, like it's not now. It's never culturally appropriate to watch someone eat. Ever. I mean, it's awkward enough, like, to do anything in front of a room of people. Can you see that I can relate? It's totally awkward to, like, do something with everyone watching. And you might know that feeling because you have had to do public speaking or something like that. But it's never actually really cool for a room of people to be watching you eat. And so they grab a piece of fish, not even like the broccoli and asparagus, right? It's like just a piece of fish, and let's see what he does with this thing. Slides it across, backs up, and then they just watch him eat. And if they're watching him eating, then Jesus is just eating. Just grabs a piece of fish, and he chomps on it. He's chewing it, and he asks them, which one of you guys made this? This is great. It's a different recipe. This is not what we were doing on the Sea of Galilee the other day. I mean, it's just unbelievable to me. And so here's the story. And I think they're all just in shock and wonder. And then Jesus explains to them, because they're confused, there's a sudden appearance. And then remember, what follows is an explanation of God's word. God had promised all of this would happen, and he wants to wake them up and realize that this story is true. They should have seen it. They should see with eyes of faith, not just with eyes of sight, with physical eyes. So Jesus explains to them once more, everything you need to know is right here in God's word. And there's nothing so plain in this story as the summary Jesus gives for the Easter message for us today. And it's found in verses 45 to 47. But all I want you to see is that at the end of Jesus telling them, hey, all of this was promised would happen, guys. You should have known. And all of this serves to the goal that God has for the Easter story. And he says it. It's like a 9-word sermon. It's a summary of the gospel here for us in at the mouth of Jesus. And it's at the end of verse 47. And it's the message that we want you to hear. It's the message of Jesus. There is forgiveness of sins for all who repent. There is forgiveness of sin for anyone who would turn to God and embrace him as the one who was alive. This is the truth. This is what Jesus says. You are witnesses of this. And that's it. That's all there is to it. There's nothing else really that's fantastical about it other than just God's sense of humor. There's really nothing else to this. He woke up from the dead, and we're being called to take a step of faith and believe that it's true. It's like Jesus showing up and us not realizing that it's him. It's like him having simply, you know, sharing with us the good news that his death paid for our sins, that he died in our place to take the punishment for our sins, and that because he woke up from the dead, he now has the power to wake us up from the dead too. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. And I think if we could share that message, this is all you would need to believe in Christ. It's like I said earlier, if Jesus appeared right here on stage, you wouldn't need any more proof than what he's got for us in God's word. You might be saying, well, I'd need to see him, or I need God to help me take away my problems and I would believe in him, or I just need a sign or some kind of miracle, and it doesn't always happen that way. It doesn't always have to happen that way. What Jesus is showing is that in all these resurrection stories, you don't actually need a miracle to receive one, like we said earlier. What I'm explaining to you is that you can hear about Jesus dying for our sins, waking up from the dead with power to forgive us and to give us new life. And the only natural response when we say this, and I should say supernatural because God helps us with this, the only response then is unbelievable. Unbelievable. This can't be true, but if it is, would you forgive me from running from you for so long? Can you promise to save me from the enemy and from the curse of my sin? And all he would say to you is, yes, that's what I came to do. There is forgiveness for all who will repent, all who will come to me. And you know what the natural response is after that? You either say thank you or you say no thanks. That's really all there is. As it pertains to the Easter message, that's really all there is. And what if someone offered you a gift? What if to Jesus, as he offers you a new life, a new perspective, what would you say to him? Thank you? No thank you? What I'm asking you to do is to see with eyes of faith. For some of you, it's going to be a step of faith, meaning you're not sure how this is going to go, but something's burning in your heart. And you're going to take a step of faith and you're going to say, God, this is hard to believe, but I embrace you as my Savior and I thank you. For Easter. I thank you for the death and the burial and the resurrection. Thank you for salvation. Is there really any other response besides thank you? In just a minute, the band's going to come as we wrap this up. The band's going to come and we're going to sing together. And what I want you to do is give you a chance to tell Jesus just that. I'm not necessarily going to lead you in a prayer. I'm not going to make you raise your hand. I'm not going to really make you come forward or anything. But I do want to give you an opportunity to pray with someone if you're interested in receiving Christ today. Or if you're interested in having someone pray with you. I'm encouraging you, would you embrace him as the risen Savior who loves you, who is willing to forgive you, and who desires a relationship with you? You know, if you turn to him, you'll find that all of your sins have gone the way of his scars. You remember what happened to all of his scars? They were gone. And when we turn to him, the same happens with our sin. They just go away. In new life, we are forgiven eternally for our sin, and there is no more condemnation for those who embrace Jesus. They will live together with God in the new creation. New bodies, new heavens, new earth. This is the good news, and I embrace you to believe it today. So would you pray with me?